weaving in and out of it.
You don't spoil everybody's fun. And I said this on Talks Machina recently. Mm-hmm. I'd love to bring her in for a short visit on the show. I don't know how to do that. That's a great Stranger Things setup. Yeah.
My students. I work at VHS, so I just localize my kids.
Awesome.
Sorry for interrupting.
No, don't worry about it. I'm casual, man. Yes. What's your name?
Sarah. This is Raishan. When you DM'd your one shot with the clasp, how hard was it when the players went way off of what you planned? Did you have like side things planned if they went differently, or did you just come up with stuff off
the
spot?
They could have gone through that house multiple. I thought about that. I don't know how Mercer does it because I
witchcraft. Yeah.
Switcher.
And I've talked to Mercer about it too. She's like, you know, they'll be having dinner or something, and his eyes will just go like. As he goes off to think about something, and I totally experienced that because the whole premise was, all right, I want everybody to have their own goals that conflict, and I want it to turn into the Hateful Eight at the end. Have everybody turn on each other, and that was the simple idea that I thought of, and then how to make sure that happened, but only have 3.5 hours for a one shot to do without making it totally railroaded. But it's not an open-ended campaign; it's just so balancing act. And I would just be washing dishes at home with the water running for 2 minutes, going, "Oh, but if they go in that door, oh no." Okay, I'll have to. And just I spent like 2 months thinking about it. Was it the first one I did? No, it was the second.
The second one you did, yeah.
Yeah, the first one was easier for me just because it was such a lark, you know, what a larking. that everything could go wrong, it would still be fun. I was a little, you know, Matt has cast a big shadow, and I was nervous to, like, do something set in his world, and full on use the rules, which I mostly understand rogue rules, but not like magic, I'm still grasping it. But they could have gone, what did they do? They went in through the basement, right?
They went through
sewer.
Yeah.
They could have gone over a fence. They could have taken out everybody on the grounds. There were guards on the grounds. They could have gone in through a tower roof. There were Adelaide Blue Button had 3 old crotchety blink dogs as pets. They would have dealt with them on the top floor and never found the mimics. They also could have got dropped down, like they found a column in that office. That column was a tube that went from the kill room down to the mimic room to dispose of bodies for the mimics to eat. So they could have used, I think there were immovable rods present somewhere, and they could have used those to make a ladder to go up through that tube and shortcut through a bunch of stuff. I really wanted them to go through the hallway of tchotchkes, though, so I'm glad they did. I don't know. I mean, it's like, what I learned from that is it takes a lot of work, and mapping out multiple ways to win. And I was also ready for the possibility of somebody getting the hell out of that room and running, and Adelaide would have come in sooner. And I would have let somebody get away. I knew that I was probably everyone was gonna die, but I would have let somebody. They would have to roll really well. No. That was a really convoluted answer.
No, it's okay. I did a one shot, so I just needed tips for when I do my next one.
Okay. Cool. Yes. What's your name?
Dee.
How are you?
Good. How are you?
I slept a lot last night, so I'm good.
That's rare. I wish I could say the same. What's the weirdest thing you've experienced at a convention?
7 or 8 years ago, I signed somebody's butt cheek. I still think like you shouldn't have signed that butt cheek.
Do you want to do it again?
It was a decent butt cheek, but I'm like,
it's like an $80 premium.
I mean, I also see sometimes people like they'll get sign my body, and then 2 days later we'll see a photo of a friend, and it's tattooed. And I'm like, please don't have my name. That's the weirdest. Yeah. Good morning.
How did you get from go from the transition of voice acting to voice directing?
So Peter met another voice actor, Crispin Freeman, took me up the audition, did a little bit of voiceover for dubbing anime in New York City. left New York, went to LA thinking maybe I could be on camera, but I got a little of this voiceover work, maybe that will work. And so I auditioned. I barely worked my first year in Los Angeles. I booked the job. I acted there. I schmacked it for a company called New Generation on a couple of shows. Technolize. I know there are others. I can't remember too well. Was that Daphne and the Deep Brilliant? The anime girl show. And after doing that, I got to know the guy who ran that company. He said, you don't seem like a total idiot. Would you like to try to? Do you know how to adapt a script, write a script? Are you a writer? And I lied and I said yes. And did it, and it worked. It came out well. And then he said, well, that wasn't too bad. Do you direct as well? And I lied again and said yes. And a couple months later, I was directing a show called Koi Kaze, which is a heartfelt, sad, bittersweet story about incest. It was a really good show, but you know, I don't know what they were thinking trying to bring it over here. So that's how. Just not, you know, show up.
Line.
Be good. Line.
Line.
Make it
until
you make it.
Be a good line. Ask us the second time.
I was good at drama and theatrical stuff, so I had no experience, but I had indirect experience. Anybody else? Yes, you again.
I don't want to hog a second question. I guess another kind of preference question, what is it like doing voice acting, like dubbing, like something that's already kind of been created, been out for a while, versus being on a fresh project and being like the first voice on it?
Sure. Very different experiences. When you're dubbing something that pre-exists, be it anime, or I've also done like live action films from Poland, or you know, that kind of thing. You have either a completely finished product or a nearly finished product. So you're seeing that giant robot lurch across the landscape. You're seeing the doofus pratfall and hit his face on the cement or whatever it is. It's there. You don't have to imagine it. You see it. So you're getting the full process. You're the full picture right there. So that's great. That feeds your imagination. You know exactly what you have to do. You even have a performance that you either are, you know, mirroring or going, nah, not that, this. But it's still a leg up. It's not nothing. However, well, hold on, then we'll jump over to original stuff. There's nothing there, and I direct people a lot too, so I see people struggle with this, where they come in from a film or TV shows, and they're great, I love them, but they're suddenly in a vacuum, there's nothing there, there is no giant robot, they're not hitting their face in the cement, and having to get them to like imagine something terrible or hilarious or something that a lot of people have trouble with is sounding like a superhero running around and talking. They'll come in and try to deliver their lines like this, when the person's like leaping through the air and throwing a lightning bolt. It sounds different than just me talking to you like this. So you're going off of nothing. So there's how original can be harder and dubbing can be easier. Now the reverse. Dubbing is technically extremely challenging because it's great to have it all, but then you are locked into timing. And you have to start on time, and pause at the right time, and end at the right time, and it's the difference between good Shatner acting and bad Shatner acting, which is finding ways to pause believably and not sound like you're, you know, a robot. So I just acted around two little pauses there, instead of picking weird places to pause. That's oversimplifying it, but that's also a challenge writing as well. I've acted on projects with a script. Is just willy-nilly broken in weird places, and you think, how do I sell that? So very technically demanding, and the people who can do it well, Laura Bailey, make it seem like magic, and then you bring someone in who's never done it, and you go like, can we get Laura Bailey? With original animation, you're not penned in by anything. Your imagination is, you know, the sky's the limit. You can do anything, nothing's too big or too small, it's just what you and the director work out together. So it's not as technically demanding. And I still like, I don't dub as much anime, mostly because it is largely in Texas now. There's not as much in Los Angeles. But anytime someone invites me to do some, I always want to, because for me, it is so much more difficult that it's like going to the gym. And the people who are good at dubbing anime are, I'm speaking from experience as a director, the best, because they get music, they get timing, understand it, crescendoing on the end or tucking it in or going big or sanding it down, all just, you know, verbal vomit that we throw at each other when we're working on these sessions. that said. Anybody else? Any first time questions? Yes, what's your name?
Rhonda.
Hi, Rhonda.
What is your favorite past character, and is there a favorite anime character you might want to, in the future, do?
So are we talking strictly anime?
Either. I'm not...
Okay.
Past, I don't care. I'm just curious about maybe an anime
or
even a video game character from the future.
Right. well, I really do love Gaara. And I liked a role in a show called Ergo Proxy, which is older. It's like a sci-fi show, and it was I don't often get cast, I think, to be like a timid version of myself, which is what I feel is my home base. I mean, like, I'm trying to chat you guys up and have fun, but I'm kind of an introvert as a home base, and I don't get cast as that. I get cast often as soldiers and big demon dudes, which is great. I think it's hysterical and love doing it, but I always feel like I'm, you know, putting on a giant foam suit to do it. And Technolize, wrong sci-fi. Ergo Proxy was basically me just thrown into a sci-fi world. In the future, I don't know, I'd love to be in the Fallout franchise in a heavier way, which is my favorite video game stories. I'd like to go back into Star Wars more. I play an Empire nitwit for Star Wars Rebels, but I'd love to do something else. I guess that's it. We'll say that. What I'd like to do? Once I played Elrond's twin sons in a Lord of the Rings game, and I would love to do that again, because I know that I have sort of nasal vocal similarity to Hugo Weaving. So if they ever go further with those twins, I'll do that. Anybody else? Yes, sir. What's your name?
Hi, I'm CJ.
CJ, welcome.
Thank you. I was just curious, what's your favorite D&D class?
Fucking rogue, man.
Besides rogue.
It's the best class. Maybe I'll fall in with wizards, but I don't know. That's how I play video games, too. I don't go charging in. I'm like, Solid Snake, can you see me? Do you see me? I don't know. Maybe I just don't like conflict. I don't agree. Drew.
Yep.
Good morning.
Hi. When you're playing Caleb, I noticed you're leaning into the requirements for each spell. I find that when you play D&D a lot, people tend to lessen that. Was that a conscious choice, or?
You mean to talk about like the
materials.
I mean, I don't know that I will do the same amount. Let's just use Chromatic Orb as an example. I don't think every time I use that spell for the next 2 years, I'm going to say the same spiel or something similar. But probably, you know, the first couple of times I, you know, roll something out. I mean, it's fun. We just feel like we're creating a radio play out of thin air, so I'm just trying to add a little. I'm the only reason I'm doing it. I know Matt said feel free to do more describing your physical attacking people, but I think I would have done this anyway just because it, you know, I get a kick out. Yes.
Well, we just talked about rogue as your favorite class. Besides assassin, have you looked into inquisitive?
Inquisitive?
Yeah, it's from Xanadu.
I did, but I don't remember what it is already.
It's like a
remind
real,
me of the color to it.
It's like a real like wisdom based kind of like insight and getting a lead up on your opponents.
So like
a sneak attack without being close to them, without being hidden.
Okay, so like a lean tactician.
Yeah.
Maybe I get that vibe off of Beauregard. Yeah, that'd be good. Mm. I also like, is Swashbuckler its own thing, or is that also
Rogue? That's our type. That's Rogue art
type. I like Swashbuckler a lot.
Yeah.
Your number to Eros. Your dragon. Does it hit your dragon? How many questions?
Well, Frumpkin is usually more of a cat than he has to be a dragon. What would Aleem O'Brien 5 years ago think if you went back and told him that you'll be doing Q&As and people are asking questions not about Gaara, not about Illidan, but about you playing Dungeons and Dragons.
I would have laughed at that guy. Gosh, things were a lot simpler in my world 5 years ago, 6 years ago. Oh man. No, I would never, I said this to yesterday's group who came for the panel, and forgive me for repeating myself, but almost every day, one of us will share a picture or somebody in cosplay, or like somebody did an 80s synth version of our theme song today. Every day, almost, we share something with each other, and the tagline is always like, doesn't make any sense, and it doesn't. I guess the only thing that I can try to explain it with is something that Will Friedle said at some point, which is just, good story is good story. And everybody in our group has spent many years working on stories, character, motivation, mystery and suspense, we're some of the best. Laura Bailey is, as a director, is my favorite actor. That's the end of that sentence. She's my favorite actor. And we play D&D together, so of course she's amazing at, pulling a character together. And there's, 8 of us doing it. And it relates to voice acting, too. I stand with people that everyone that I work with, I'm very good friends with a lot of people in the voiceover industry. And still, I stand next to them. I stood next to Troy Baker working on a thing last week, and he gave he did a scene with somebody. It was short, it was quiet, and I was just like, and we get, it's every, oh, 5 minutes? Oh, wow, that was fast. I'm spoiled to spend my time with some of the most creative people on the planet. And I consider myself like quintuply blessed at this point. I'm very grateful for it. Thank you for following along on our nitwit cow transforming adventure.
Will there be more cows?
I hope so. The cows are much more totalitarian though on Wild Mountains. You don't want to mess with them. If there's any other new questions, we'll go to you, back to you. Yes, sir.
My name's Matt. Were there things that you were trying to consciously stay away from when you were developing Caleb?
Never say never, but I'm not like right out of the gate. None of us were. I'm not like, I can't wait to get another one on the show, because I explored that pretty heavily. But never say never, but I'm not looking for it. I didn't want to be the person who rushed in anymore. I'm pretty heavy with the German accent now. I wasn't sure what I was going to do with that. And I'm still not sure. That can change 7 episodes from now. But I wanted to sit in another voice that was not hard to do, but different. And just, I'm still playing with the dial on that. And then anything else I don't want to talk about. Yeah, right. Someone over here. Yes, sir. What's your name?
My name's Nick. I prefer Ducky, though.
What do you prefer?
I prefer Ducky.
Ducky? Ducky.
Yeah.
All right, Ducky.
Is there an actor, director, writer, anything you'd like to see guest star on Critical Role?
Oh, yeah. I mean, we have a few people that we know, so I won't say them out loud. We're probably going to join us. Colbert is the one that everyone talks about. I'd love to play with Colbert and Conan O'Brien both. I'd love down the line to see Mary do something else. I'm not sure. I don't know. What do I got? A minute? I'm over. Am I over? Okay, so those are the two, O'Brien and Colbert, and then last question.
Besides Caleb, who's your new favorite character?
Oh, in the group?
Yeah.
She's so unique. I mean, just the character design and Sam's nutty voice that came out, which wasn't there, like Game Zero. And I just love the dynamic, and I know that being paired up with Sam is gonna. I can't say that. But Sam is a genius. I've always known that. He's just like a creative comedy anarchist, and he can do it. There it is. That's the answer. All right, guys. Thank you.
Thank you.
Signing stuff in a half hour, and I'll wait. Don't come up. I'm not gonna sign anything now, just so I can be fair to everybody. But I'll be over there in a half hour. I'm gonna go drink some more coffee. Enjoy the con. Enjoy the Wonder Bowl.